should have seen that one coming.
Vega squadrons, turn to ban. Ten seconds remaining. Dire team ban. Ten seconds remaining. Vega squadrons, turn to ban. Ten seconds remaining. Dire team pick.
Vengeful spirit.
Vega squadrons, turn to pick.
Zeus, I speak for the trees.
Dire team.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Dota Pit Season 4 by G2A. I'm Toby One, host for the English live stream tonight, and this is our final game for the evening. That is right. It is sad time. Speaking of sad, my co-caster, who's actually happy, cancel. Amen. Your mic is out, man. Happy to do something.
Beastmaster.
You're like at half
Dire
volume.
Team ban.
It happened once during the game as well, but it only lasted for a split second, and then it corrected itself. Nope.
10 seconds remaining.
Nope.
Vega squadrons, turn
near you,
to
but
back.
You're a long way away. Now you're back.
Hmm. Okay. Well, I mean, I'm just closer to the mic now. that's
definitely not what it
Vega
was.
Vega squadrons,
I think
turn
that's
yeah.
some kind of weird connection thing.
Yeah, maybe I need to check my mic after this game. But there's two things I want to say. Your introduction. I am happy for a very strange reason. Which is that I didn't know it was possible, but I got a tournament drop from that last game. Can you, as a caster, is that normal?
It's actually started happening again. As a caster, it always happened back in the past. And then Valve were just like, there's too many items. Like, that was the reason for the recycling process coming in. Everyone was getting these weird, shitty little drops all the time, and it was just flooding the market with crap. And they wanted to clean it up. Well, I don't know if that directly affected the tournament drops, but it happened about a year and a half ago, where tournament drops just stopped completely. I watched every single game from TI. Like, I had my laptop running back in the hotel, watching auto games on auto watch, every single one. I didn't get a single drop. But last night when I was casting Dota Pit, I got a drop for a courier kill.
Yeah.
And I'm just
well,
like,
that's, I,
yay!
Yeah, I got like the end of game drop for that game. Like a rare invoker. It's pretty cool, actually.
You lucky son of a...
Yeah. But,
I got a crappy Omni Knight helmet. Like, I'm never going to use this. I don't play
Vega
balanced heroes. Let's look at our game, man.
Yeah, on the drafts, I actually what I wanted to say, like, actually at the start of the draft, and we kind of just got, like, sidetracked, is...
We did.
In the lobby, first game, Vega chose Dire, and Mama's Boys chose first pick, and that's very normal in this patch. It's very normal for a long time. One team is Dire, the other's first pick, maybe the other way around, doesn't matter. In the second game, Mama's Boys chose Dire, and Vega chose second pick. They actually picked second pick, and I was wondering why they would, and I think the start of their draft answers that, because... In this patch, you usually see if one team starts with Zeus or Nature's Prophet, the other team immediately takes the other one. People don't like giving teams the global strategy. You also see Mama's Boys have picked the A and picked the Spectre now. So it's like, there's a very clear focus in the current meta where teams know that if the other team has all the global stuff, they're in trouble. So I think it makes sense then Vega take the second pick, make sure they get at least the two pieces, but Mama's Boys have made sure they don't get any of the other pieces.
It's brutal for anyone out there. Like, I know for people who have been grinding pub games, when you have a Spectre and a Zeus on the opposite team, you just want to give up. You know, there's no way you're going to win. Like, there's no way. Unless you can properly coordinate the cleaning up of it, you just take too much damage too fast. Now, Vega, because they were denied that, they had to go down another road. They pick up the Abaddon, who has been less popular of late. I know that's kind of weird to say, but he doesn't seem to take... Like, I haven't seen him play the offlane as much, at least in this patch.
Yeah. No, it's actually... So Starlight, I didn't see it picked at all, but I did see it banned a few times. It was one of those interesting things where, like, certain players were disrespected. Alliance got it banned against themselves a few times, actually. So, it's definitely still a hero that's around. And actually, something interesting about Vega Squadron with their global strategy is... This team in particular, when they pick global strategies, it's usually a push strategy that has global elements to it. And it's why Mama's Boys banned the Lycan, the Chen, and the Shadow Shaman afterwards. Because Vega don't actually go all in global. Their plan is, it's very sophisticated. We're going to group up and push, and your usual plan to deal with us pushing is to split push. But if you try split push, we've got the global power to pick you off. And this is actually something Vega did against EG in the second game of the elimination match at Starlight, and they nearly won. With this approach, I think they possibly should have won. I would go as far as to say so. It's actually a very clever draft from Vega, and from the side of Mama's Boys, like, it's good that they denied some of the global power, they denied some of the pushing power, but they're still gonna have to deal with that dynamic as the game develops, probably. Unless they just dominate the early stage, they're gonna have to deal with the fact that Vega want to push you, and it's difficult to actually split push against them.
Thank you so much.
Can you see Crystal Bane and Zeus swapping all the time?
Yep.
Yeah.
Seema and no one are switching back and forward.
Oh, wait, I'm like, I really want to see a mid Crystal Maiden.
I didn't think that was possible when we're in this screen.
Yeah, also, I don't know.
Because you don't have a swap command. It has to be a bug. Either that, or they found a way to manipulate it. Go back and forward.
The one thing about Vegas draft, I mean, I'm talking about how they have this, like, they push you, but you can't split push because they have global. Previously, when I've seen this draft, they usually have good catch as well. Like, their support would be a Shadow Shaman or Bane or something that catches you out, and then the Nature's Prophet and Zeus LT and TPN and stuff, and I don't really...
Your mic's done the same thing again, man.
Really?
And you're back.
Okay, so it actually genuinely seems like if I'm like slightly too far away from my mic, it just freaks out. Like, that doesn't make any sense to me, but like I move a little bit and then...
Separation anxiety.
Yes. I don't know. That's
odd.
All right.
Very odd.
Yeah, it's odd to say the least, but I'm going to be checking my settings and stuff after this. And for now, I'll just make sure that I stay very, very close.
I'm just checking out a couple of the effigies now because, wait, we got ourselves a pause. And it seems like Lion has bad breath. Like, mm-hmm. He just seems to be breathing some weird crap. Unless someone's trying to steal his soul. Weird thing above him. Everyone's once very, very classic, the Ice Baby. Very few, like, Pasha actually has a centaur for his effigy. So few people actually use a centaur effigy. That's unique in a way. Oh, you've moved back away again. I can't hear you. I don't know what's doing it. Someone's doing it. Try speaking again at some point. I'm assuming you're crawling behind your computer right now trying to work out what the hell's going on. It's weird, it's perfect one moment and then it's consistent the next. Everyone's back in, we can go, yay! I spoke too soon. Yes, wings are just so nicely done. Oh, and I want you, Beastmaster. Vengeful spirit. Very, very simple. They attach in so nicely. This is something you couldn't cosplay as. This one would be impossible to create. You could do this part pretty well. That actually would be... You need a back brace, but that'd be fairly easy. Alright. How you going there, Scant? Alright, so we've actually fully lost Scant right now. Not from the call, just from all forms of audio. I'm still getting in and out quick. EP's out to do the same kind of thing from Vega here, which is a little surprising. Especially when you're looking to try and control up your own jungle at this point. So Crystal Maiden just can power level inside the jungle. That's exactly what Seema wants to do. This is a high mana intensive lineup from Vega. They want to have all of the points up in an aura that you can possibly get. Just try and contest bottom lane. So Beastmaster offlane for Monkey Business, no surprise from Sexy Bamboo. And they then run that mid lane Queen of Pain. And here we see a lot less. Late. An apparition of VS can go wherever the hell they want, and Pycat. Looks like he's getting ready to Spectral Dagger for the top rune, but it's gonna be a full contest for the bottom rune. With the shields up on no one. Yeah, Hook, you're not getting that rune. Begins. Top one, Pycat will have the choice if he just takes it down and goes top. He's gonna babysit it. They really want to get it into the hands of the Queen of Pain. He's even gonna skill up Blink to make sure she gets there. Or anyone else does. Worthy tribute. This will make it so Pycat's a little late to the wave. This will allow a Treant pull to happen. So you send three out to pull the wave, and then send the other one around to block up the camp. Bit of a miss marker because it ended up coming back again, but this basically makes it impossible for that top lane. Mama's boys won't look for that. Like, they won't burn a sentry for it. They'll walk around and instantly go, okay, there's no camp there. If this tree doesn't reveal itself, it would have been even better. The scan's actually fully dropped now. See when and how he gets back. Ever mark again, Scant? No. I don't hear anything. Alright, so this top lane. Very difficult for Mama's boys to actually get the upper hand up against Mag. You can harass them out with a lot with the Treants. Maybe not so great up against a hero like a Spectre, but you've got the Abaddon behind you. He offers you a lot of protection, and in fact, Sol is just trying to get as much as he can by farming in the jungle, too. Okay, it looks like Scan's gonna need a little bit longer to work out his problems. It's still gonna be a pretty good lane for Bamboo as long as Seema doesn't get too close, but now the boots are up to Seema. He can close that distance and try and go for the Frostbite. Which is kind of like now, but he's using it to kill off the boars. Bamboo was never going to fall for that, though. He'll deny it every single time. But Seema can at least make his play for the runes. So both the supports actually soak up these first runes.
Invisibility.
The rest of the mid heroes just trying to get as much charge into the bottles as possible. No one going for a little bit more of a farming kind of build with the Arc Lightning. He's to try and chip down the Queen of Pain a little bit more to do exactly that. Need to make sure he had just enough mana to do it and able to get that rotation to mid. Now, normally it's the second point in Arc Lightning. It's about the exact amount of bounces you get in the creep wave. It allows you to farm up the range creep as well. that more and more mids are getting used to playing up against the Zeus. That's where you saw it, like when the creep wave was just in this area, the Queen of Pain moved up this way. So standing a little bit further up keeps her out of range of the bounce. So you have to make a choice, like, do you farm the wave or do you actually, like, attack into the hero? And that second Arc Lightning, which was popped by no one, may have actually, like, it should have probably flagged to Hook that something was coming his way, because no one used it directly on the Queen of Pain, and it didn't bounce to the creep wave. That was no one just trying to do that earlier chip damage. He's also gonna watch his positioning, because if he just stands here and no one goes for the lightning bolt to just chip him down, he's gonna reveal the observer ward as well. That's gonna happen anyway. Nothing's really gonna stop that. And this will make it so Queen of Pain's have a lot less information as far as the roaming ganks go. Actually still getting a lot of CS on this bot lane. Good levels this way too. But this will all be balanced out for the fact that Pycat's still getting a lot of his farm. So we're gonna see the phase boots and probably urn build. It's the most consistent one of Spectres at the moment. And all he's got to do is just find level 6 and haunt in. Bambo actually getting caught out while trying to go for the rune. Bag's first rotation now lets him finish up his own phase boots. Gets lucky with the regeneration rune being up on the top river. Become a very disgusting time. And Talon farming with an Abaddon. Easily out of power level himself up. Dan was talking about this in the previous game, where the offlaners have so many more options now, just because they've got that Iron Talon, they can farm a lot quicker, and still be effective in the game. But you can also get away with these Caridia 4 positions because of, like, an item like Iron Talon. We have a bottle refresh and just right now.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
I hear a scant click. Nope, it's gone again. And it's back.
Are you serious?
No, you're distorting out, man. You're distorting out at a very low level. Wow, look. That's aggressive. Blinks forward. And now the Nature's Prophet is going to try and capitalize for the Thunder God's Wrath up. He doesn't go for the Sprout. Did he get the vision? The attacks are going to be enough, though. Death. Oh, for a moment, you're just going to sprout the hillside. Maybe he was worried the Queen of Pain had a lower level up on Blink. Looks like they're also capitalizing that Thunder God's Wrath with Pasha coming in for a spin of what I assume to be a frostbite from Seema. Now making a 4-0 in favor of Vega. Let's try it again, Scant. How are you doing? Nope. Still broken. You know what? I'm just gonna check something just in case it's not your end and it's actually mine.
Please!
No, my end was fine, and now yours is actually fine.
What?
Yep. Mike just corrected itself. Don't ask me how, it just happened. Bambo, gonna go for the roar, trying to create a little bit of space. The frostbite from Seema, he needs vision. And that's why Prophet's coming in, but Hook the Omni Slash! And the frostbite from Seema, a great choice of targets. As she interrupted the Queen of Pain, she wanted to go for that Sonic Wave. Because the frostbite hit her at the exact time, Pasha could kill her. And now it's right. 6-0 for Vega, they don't lose anything. Welcome back, Scat.
Yeah, so I actually like have no idea what just happened. It was really weird when I was trying to fix my mic, then my keyboard stopped working, then my internet went off, so I was like, there's some spooky stuff going on. I honestly, like, originally it seemed like everything's fine. I couldn't find anything that would be wrong. So I was just like unplugging things, plugging them back in, and but yeah, it looks like I watched like little bits in between while I was trying to fix stuff, and it does look like Vega's strategy is just kind of working, and they're even better than what it is planned, because usually the strategy, like once Zeus and Furion hit level 6, that's where it like starts to peak, and they've just been dominating the lane stage even before then.
Just these moments, like Hook's been trying to get aggressive, oh they got the vision at the end too, because the Orbs ward, the Wrath of Nature kicks over. It's the over-aggression that's come out from Hook. It's now made because he is over 50% of the deaths of his team. Because it's a 0-4 Queen of Pain. He's trying to push the envelope up against the Zeus. And hey, while we have your mic, I want to ask you, why do you think Queen of Pain has dropped off from the scene? She's Like, I don't know the exact stats, I just know the feeling of at least most of the games I've been watching. The Queen of Pain has become a very low priority when it comes to the mid laners.
Yes, I don't know. I mean, professional players probably give you a more simple answer. I'm not really sure. I think there's like, there's complicated things to be said about it. One is that most Queen of Pain players can't play the hero as a carry the way like Sumail or Ferrari might. So it's a tempo controller, and most teams are not really running mid tempo controllers. They're running mid heroes that can scale into like very, very high damage. There's also something to be said for the fact that the hero is just not dominating the lane as much anymore, because there were some nerfs so that lower level Scream of Pain deals less damage. It's the same once you max it out, but it's not the same on the low levels.
It's also watching her going up against something like a Zeus. Like, she just lost almost all of her life from just a simple bolt. In fact, no one, I'm watching this, even though Bambo dies on bottom lane, this is just Bambo things. It looks like Abad's gonna have trouble up on top, he's gonna shield and die. The Wrath of Nature bounces, it doesn't bounce up though! He must have lost vision, he must have died too early. They've lost the vision on both the VS as well as the Ancient Apparition. But that could have been easily a double kill in return.
Yeah, what I actually like about this version of Vega's draft, I mean, I've seen them do the Zeus Viren plus like pushing elements many times. And I was saying the crystal meta didn't fit because it doesn't catch people out as the initiation, or Zeus actually gets the bolts into fog. But the crystal maiden's really cool here in the sense that this is a hero that really helps your early game. And actually, when I've seen Vega do these drafts before, sometimes when
Spectral Horn's gonna come down, Pasha. There's still enough for this. Your reality in. Look, he doesn't have mana for the Sonic Wave. He's bottling up for it now. They've already killed off Nature's Prophet. Solo, he's just so short of having his ultimate, so he's gonna shield up, they'll axe through the tree line, there goes your Sonic Wave to ensure the kill. Queen of Pain needed something, and that's a first kill. Not a bad one considering Solo had been, not zoning out, but fighting head-to-head with a Spectre Solo.
Yeah, it actually links to what I was about to say, so to finish the point, it's they pick the Crystal Maiden because sometimes the draft that they, this kind of draft is susceptible to early game control because yeah, their early game is quite dependent on ultis. We're talking last game about late game or mid game being dependent on ultis, but actually Vega's early game when they pick Zeus Viren is dependent on ultis, and the Crystal Man's meant to fill in the...
They don't even need... They're gonna use it! Oh, oh no!
Oh!
17 HP, he survives! And Seema was baited into chasing it too, he thought he could have an opening. He's gonna get hit by the axes, Bamboo is still gonna die. Thanks to Thunder God's Wrath for that one on the Observe Ward, they're still sitting inside the lane. Hence free and easy kill. Asha wants to battle up against Pycap. He's short by one mana to have that Spectral Dagger. And he's gonna get over the ridge and away! 51 HP, he'll survive. Yep, we're getting body blocked. Pasha's just gonna... Okay, that was
Yes, I am.
Require the Omni Slash when no one's there with a Thunderbolt.
So, yeah. Mama's boys are getting something. And there's no reason they need to be getting anything, to be honest. So I guess that's good for them. But at the same time, Vega are definitely getting more and getting further ahead. And the, I don't know, the one hope I think for Mama's boys is they get a very big fight where Spectre lives. Like if they win a fight by like 5-4 or 4-3, it doesn't have to be like the wipe. But they win a big fight and Spectre stays alive through the fight, all of a sudden you have another big item and then they can be looking alright.
This is just so crazy what Nabatan can do. He's level 6, yeah. He's a 1-3-1 build. But the VS is like staring him down in mid lane. Doesn't want to stun, doesn't want to swap, doesn't want to do anything. Solo just runs at him with a shield on. Because if Yabsor does force any issues here, he's gonna get bolted by the Thunder God's Wrath, which is now level 2. And the Wrath of Nature is also up. So this is that double ulti combo. The Thunder God's Wrath to give the vision, then the Wrath of Nature to also connect. So when the two of them are up at the same time, you're always going to hit everything. Unless your timing, like your bounce timing is really delayed. I don't know if Asha felt that coming or not, but the Ice Blast won't be able to connect. And you can say goodbye to Zeus, where's the reality? He actually goes on no one, Pycat trying to make this play. And well, Zeus not popping off the rune. There's only an arcane anyway. But now they go for a counter attack. It's Bambo on the bottom lane. He can go for that roll, which does stop Asha from chasing him. The Seema gets the kill.
It's a place where the Spectre is a nice hero against the kind of global strategy because each time, like, The points in the global power from Vega is that they can kill someone wherever they want, but Spectre is going to be like, well, if a few of you get isolated to make a kill somewhere on the map, I can actually go in and finish you off afterwards. Unfortunately for Pycat, his team's so far behind that Vega gets to like go for kills in multiple places at once, and he definitely can't clean up in both of those places.
Too, because even when you go in, you have to understand that you won't be able to chase another kill. Because you go in for the fight, when they go to Wrath of Nature hits you, the illusions actually help provide more damage in the engagement. Pycat, he's out of range of the Thunderbolt. Even with that lens, it isn't capable of reaching. But yeah, when you have that double ulti up, you take so much damage at the early point of the fight, you need to have some high level of sustain. And they don't have a mech carrier. In fact, no one's building a mech over on Mama's Boys. Because you're getting an early Necro book built from the Beastmaster. The Ancient Apparition won't be able to build one. The VS definitely won't be able to build one. So I'm wondering where the sustain comes from Mama's Boys, compared to what Vega have. Which is healing ward, obviously, but what Abaddon can then give to the rest of his team. Catch out the Ancient Apparition in the river. Like an Omni Slash to help ensure it.
Yeah, I even saw last time they played this drop, Mara actually bought mech on his Furion, but I guess because they've got the Abaddon, the Furion doesn't have to go for the mech.
Yeah. And they still want to have something like an Orc up against the Queen of Pain, because there's no way Hook is getting a BKB after dying 4 times so far in the game. They just probably just got a solo kill on the bottom. Down the ascent, Hook is very, very low, but the Thunder God's Wrath still on cooldown.
The Crystal Maiden helped out a bit. What wasn't completely solo.
But, it still pushes like Thunder God, Nature's Wrath now to level 2. No one's waiting for the right time to strike. You can't kill Axel with that.
You're asking. Sorry, I keep in.
There's 350 damage against the 305, but with the hero dog, yeah, he can't. That's not enough.
No. Yeah, I kind of left you hanging when you asked where the sustain's going to come from, because I basically think you're right that it's not going to come from anywhere, and it's going to be a problem.
It's just a simple answer, and there is none. No one Bambo goes for this build, but if he doesn't go for this build, they can't really force any team fights because they've been completely outmatched right now. That's the huge problem.
Yeah, it's definitely a fact about Beastmaster. I mean, the strength of the hero is meant to be how much it does when it does get Necro 3, but like the kind of corollary of that is that you sort of have to go for the Necro 3 almost always in this hero in a competitive match, and that kind of pushes you into a corner because you, exactly as you say, you have offlaner that's probably not buying the mech. And in this kind of game, you've got two very poor supports, so you're unlikely to get there.
Even Crystal Maiden could have fallen something like a mech, but she's building in from what I assume is Seamus BKB.
Yeah, as we said, their team doesn't really need the mech, because they got Abaddon.
Yep.
And he's actually, he's going to build a Vlad's or mech or something of his own, and that's all he has to do, really.
That makes a lot of sense if Vega are going to force the engagements earlier on. Pycat's going to get chipped a little bit. And you do wonder, like, because you've got this Spectre pickup, and Spectre builds phase as well as earn. You're looking to fight early on with this and get a good engagement. But at the moment, I'm not seeing an avenue to do that. So you've got a build which, at this point, just gives stats to the Spectre. Like, Mama's Boys are forced back into this thing again where it's trade-off gaming.
Yeah,
Vegas still have the sweet spot of the timing. Attack.
Yeah, they go for the trade-offs whenever they can, and exactly like last game, there's going to come a point where they have to win a fight. And last game, they did actually win one fight defending their base, but unfortunately for them, they lost another one like almost immediately afterwards. And in this game, it's similar actually. They win a big fight, Spectre lives, finishes the Radiance, gets somewhere. At that point, they can start coming back into the game. Trade-offs is out of necessity for now, but it's just a matter of time before Mama's Boys have to try win a fight.
They're TPing down. They want Bambo and Yapsaw. They're looking for the double ulties with the Wrath of Nature kicking through. Bambo's TP will be cancelled. So it's two heroes down. MB, they do take out that mid-tier one. And that's all they're really going to get. Seema's walking over to them. This is a cocky Crystal Maiden. And he sees Hook TPing out. They also see, well, no one else on the map because their observer wards are covering everything, so they have to assume that MB's gone all the way back home.
So something interesting about Vega Squadron, like, everyone was happy when they saw yet again that they said they're not going to be making changes to their lineup. They actually have made some kind of internal change from what I can tell. It looks like Solo and Seema have kind of switched around, because Solo was always the roaming player and Seema was the defensive one. And in both of the games this series, we saw Seema on the bench and Solo as Dazzle, and now we see Seema on the CM and Solo on Abaddon. So Solo is actually taking a more reactive role, and Seema is becoming the more proactive support in this team.
It's an interesting kind of change, because what are they looking to achieve between the two of them? Like, is Seema's timing a little bit better than Solo's?
I mean,
seen it work so well as a five-man squad. I never really thought about, like, the dual combo.
I honestly get the feeling that maybe Solo was frustrated. In some of these games at Starlight, it felt like he would make really good individual plays, and then it looked like you could see he's frustrated that things aren't working out. And it's an interesting spot to be in when you're like the playmaking support. You actually have to be quite patient, even though you're a playmaker, because you have to know that like your role in the team is still a support role. And so if I had to take a wild guess, I'd say that they considered that maybe Solo thinks too much like a core player, and so to remind him that he's like definitely a support, put him on like the protective support, which like gets constantly reminded all game, because the only thing an Abaddon does is heal people. The only thing a Dazzle does is save people. So in that sense, it makes sense to me that he's not going to get frustrated about, you know, things that actually core players are meant to be frustrated about, because he's right in his face. He's a healer. That's what he's doing.
That's, I think, that with the simple change.
I mean, so far so good. They look very good last game, they look very good this game, so...
Oh, they're in a little bit of trouble if they overstay their welcome here. The Ice Blast will connect on 3, Pash just tries to spin himself away. They're halfway through Roshan, and they still haven't used the Healing Ward. So now the Ice Blast wears off, they can drop that Healing Ward. The Wave of Terror kicks in, but that's actually
helps
helping them because it's now negative armor on Roshan. There's no vision from Yapsaw, so we can't swap out, and Vega will take Roshan. Aegis the Immortal into the hands of Pasha. I get another question mark kind of thing about that, because he runs in the Omni Slash. I suppose with the Battle Fury, his damage sustained during the fights is a lot more. I always just look to the squishy Intel Nuka that's able to just bring all of his nukes back again, which is the Zeus in this case.
Zeus is looking pretty good. I mean, all three of their cores are right at the top. The Spectre's kind of close, but we saw how badly Quap did in lane, and Beastmaster's in the off lane, so...
I know he's there. Pambo! You have an Observer Ward below that tree line, and you have an Observer Ward above that tree line.
Yeah, it's what you... like... He felt pressure to go Necros, but actually in this position, going Necros, like, slowly from behind low-level Necros, it's pretty much a useless item.
Okay, so the mid tower goes down. Book will at least kill off a courier. So, if you were following my camera perspective inside Dota Pit, if you have bought the ticket, congratulations, you may have just hit yourself a drop. That tier 3 tower is toast. No Beastmaster up for 8 seconds. There's no way Bambo wants to use his buyback, because then he's completely giving up on finishing up his Necro books. But while he's not buying back, they lose the mid tower. Thunderbolt, oh god.
Look at Spikeout.
70 HP on the AA.
Spikeout needs 100 gold for Radiance, and so they actually just don't want to fight until he finishes it.
This is just such a better decision now from Vega. Like, we saw what happened to them when they tried to go pre-20 minute, push up to the high ground and gain number 1. And this one, they're in such a better position, getting that kill as well. They knew that they could capitalize straight away. Push the lane, it was in a good position as well, and now Mama's boys are staring down the barrel of a 2-0 loss.
Yeah, this is the fight though. This is Pikehead as Radiance, and the first fight off the Radiance Inspector is always huge, especially if you're behind. And Mama's boys have to win this fight. The next time Spectre casts Haunt, they need to get a lot of value. And if they don't, they almost definitely lose another side of Rax if they don't get big value out of that first one.
Mama's boys just really get so unlucky. They just find an Observer Ward right on top of a sentry. Vega walk this area, which they then draw a line saying, let's walk this way. Yeah, they're gonna see everything. Have you got a defensive observer ward up on the top lane so they can see on the hawk that flew in, but now they'll also see Yapsaw and Bambo rotating in behind him. They trigger the drum charge. Now Spectre wants to try and commit Mag, just gets out of there. They roar to cancel off that TP of Mag and commit heavily to kill off the Nature's Prophet.
He can buy back. He can buy back. If Vega wanted some advice, Mag can actually buy back with his ulti. So Mama's Boys needs to be careful.
Thundergod's Wrath. Nature's Prophet still not doing it yet. Oh, well, yeah, the Haster is just trying to reach up. The AA hides in the tree line.
It's because Vega don't have the caps, that's what I was saying earlier, so it's a bit more risky to use the buyback.
Now they can isolate Pycat. He moves nicely in the tree lines, however, so they can't get the initial opening they wanted. But with the Eel Scepter up, now Pycat's going to get nuked down pretty heavily. The Ice Blast's going to fly a little too short, so partial unaffected, and Pycat just walks direct into his blade. Solo kept the rest of Mama's Boys at bay. Just running forward. Kuyuna's triggered by Bambo. There's his level 3 Necrobooks, which now go on to cooldown as well.
And mid lane, Mag is trying to solo kill Queen of Pain. Almost catches, but brings away.
Now he ran around inside that call feed for a very long time.
By the way, during that fight, CM actually finished BKB. So if they don't use Venge or Beastmaster ulti, that's CM BKB ulti can actually just kill the whole team. It's really, really strong.
Plaster on the front lines. He's trying to burn that Aegis. Funny thing is, though, they're not doing enough damage to kill him. This top tower is dropping pretty quickly. Even, like, are they getting a Sonic Wave to push it back? Hook does have that Aghanim Scepter up now. Waiting for the right chance for Thunder God's Wrath. Well, you can take that roar out of the equation. Bamboo just got completely destroyed. They still have Thunder God's Wrath as well. Now they swap in Yapsaw. Thunder God's Wrath, now might be a good time to let it rip. That's exactly what happens. Bouncing through the Mama's Boys lineup. Thema triggers the BKB ulti, cancels the remaining TP. There's two lanes of Braxes. And Pasha just gonna go in for the Omni Slash. A nice blink away will save Hook's life. Pasha, wait, okay, they're committing and they're gonna actually force out the GG. No more time to waste. The Ghost Hunter up from solo, but this game is done. This series is done. And Vega will take it 2-0.
Yeah, and this is the kind of thing I like about Vega Squadron. This team sticks together. They fail to qualify for a major. They didn't get as far as they wanted to at Star Ladder, but they stick together, they come back, they start their next like round of matches, and they look very serious about what they're doing, actually, and get the result for it. It's quite convincing, 2-0. Almost the stomp, honestly.
Well, that puts them now level with London Conspiracy, who also have 3 points. Mama's Boys, I hate